नमस्कार। व्हेन वी थिंक ऑफ इनोवेशन, द वर्ड्स लाइक टेक्नोलॉजी, फ्यूचरिज्म, आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस पॉप अप इन आवर माइंड्स। वी से द फ्यूचर इज हियर, एंड स्पेशली इफ वी टॉक अबाउट द एजुकेशन, वी लुक आफ्टर गूगल्स एंड माइक्रोसॉफ्ट्स टू रिवोल्यूशनाइज द एजुकेशन सिस्टम। बट वॉट इफ वी लर्न दैट द टॉप एग्जीक्यूटिव्स ऑफ दीज टेक जायंट्स सेंड देयर किड्स टू अ स्कूल which says big no to technology. They prefer a school with direct interaction of a teacher and a student, a school where human interactions are not augmented by the gadgets. You might wonder, do they send their kids to the third world countries? No. Such schools exist in tier 1 cities and metros. One such school is a Waldorf school. New York Times published an article on this school entitled "A Silicon Valley School That Does Not Compute."
That sounds amazing. I'll go and read more about it. But here my question is, in this backdrop, as per you, what options could be explored by a teacher, especially a management teacher?
Well, while I was pursuing my doctoral research at MDI Gurgaon, I had same question in my mind, and I started ways of improving the quality of education. Fortunately, I visited a Gurukul. Prior to that visit, I also thought that Gurukuls are a phenomena of past, non-existent today. But all such myths got busted, and in 3 years of my doctoral work, I came to know that thousands of Gurukul exist in our country and even outside our country.
Gurukuls exist today? That sounds interesting. Please share something more about your research.
I started spending time at Gurukuls, learning Sanskrit, Bhagavad Gita and other scriptures. During this time, I found that they have something interesting to offer. Their content and pedagogy was very creative and innovative. So my mind started wondering, what is that we can learn and adopt from Gurukul for contemporary education system? The outcome of this research was very interesting and exciting. This provided a new horizon and a perspective to the concept of education. And with the passage of time, I realized that many senior professors and excellent researchers all over the world studied Bharati culture and scriptures to derive the learning for contemporary times.
So let's hear from you something about Bharatiya system of education. And also, it would be great if you throw light on the ideas that can be derived for management education.
Yes, sure. We can discuss three dimensions of the Gurukul education system, namely content, pedagogy and outcomes. First, content. In Gurukul, the content is broadly divided into four categories. First is Ved, Vedang and Shruti, Darshan Shastra, Niti Shastra, Dharma Shastra, Smriti Granth, and fourth is Itihas and Puran. First, we will talk about Ved. Ved are also known as Shruti and are the fundamental knowledge and the first ever sound generated leading to the origin of universe. Vedang, as the name suggests, these are Jyotish, Chand, Kalp, Nirukt, Vyakran and Shiksha. Moving further to Darshan Shastra, it is said that drishyate aner iti darshanam, meaning something that throws light on the phenomena and the knowledge gets revealed. There are numerous darshans which were developed by rishis, munis, thinkers and philosophers over the time. The difference in process is what makes them appear different, and this has been highlighted and evangelized by many Indologists. But rarely do they draw the reader's attention to the fact that the conclusion of all darshan is same.
Such a large number of darshans and the conclusions converge. I am eager to know that.
Yes. Initially, I was also surprised to see that Nyaya, Vaisheshik, Yoga, Mimamsa, Sankhya and other, even some of the Nastik darshan, they conclude or converge at the same point. But then I realized by reading a book and it was mentioned that jis buddhi ko bhagwan ne banaya, vah buddhi bhagwan ko kaise janegi. This was an interesting point, and I would deliberately not choose to elaborate much and leave up to the audience to ponder over it. Third comes Niti Shastra and Dharma Shastra. These are the scriptures which contain details of conduct, roles and responsibilities of people in public life, in professional life and personal lives. These may include more than 45 Smriti Granths like Manu Smriti, Yajnavalk Smriti, etc. Niti Shastra includes works like Vidur Niti, Chanakya Niti, Panchatantra. Now, third, the most interesting and one of my favorites, that is Itihas and Puran. The knowledge contained in above three types of sources is humongous, and thus it becomes difficult for a person to comprehend. But education and knowledge should be for all. Thus, with this purpose, Rishi Valmiki composed Ramayana and Maharshi Vyas compiled Mahabharata and Puran. These carry same knowledge as contained in Ved, Vedang, Dharma Shastra, Niti Shastra, etc. But in a simpler language and in form of stories, metaphors and analogies.
This is very interesting observation. In the current times, there is huge emphasis on the interdisciplinary learning, storytelling, etc. So, this idea can really provide us the relevant inputs.
Yes, it will be pertinent here to mention that Banasthali Vidyapeeth University, which was pioneer in bringing Bharati ethos to management education in year 1996. Later on, many institutions have been following this path. The recent initiatives at Stanford on storytelling project, IIM Ahmedabad introducing Panchatantra for management education, spirituality in business management, etc. are signals of the change that we are witnessing. So, bringing more and more ideas from Bharati wisdom can help us to improve the management education. See, looking for new ideas from outside is good, but doing so at the cost of ignoring better ideas at home and ignoring the indigenous wisdom cannot be considered thoughtful. Thus, synthesis of ideas from multiple perspectives is the right way out, as even suggested in Bhagavad Gita by Bhagwan Krishna, that Madhya Marg is the best approach to take while avoiding the extremes.
That is really very innovative. I think even if we adopt some of these ideas, it can bring drastic changes in our management education. But a question comes to my mind, what kind of pedagogical innovations would be required for delivering this type of content? For this, what are the ideas you would like to share based on your research?
Yes, that is coming next, the pedagogy part. The teaching processes are many times considered more important than the content itself. A teacher might have got beautiful content, high quality research, but if it is not effectively delivered, all efforts go in vain. Thus, Gurukul education takes a holistic approach to the education pedagogy. First, we can discuss the concept of Acharya, and it is not equivalent to a teacher. Second is Swalamban based skill development. Third, Dincharya, or inculcating discipline and an effective, efficient utilization of resources through that. Fourth, multi-channel learning. So, we will discuss all these four points one by one. First, let us discuss the concept of Acharya. The meaning of Acharya is inherent in the pedagogy of Gurukul itself. Acharya means the person who teaches by example. These days, we generally call it lead by example. Acharan is the fundamental part of the Gurukul education. As you might be aware that the Gurukuls are fully residential in nature, the teacher is present with the student for all 24 hours. So, a student observes teacher's lifestyle and tries to emulate it. Thus, this is in a sharp contrast to the idea of teacher that we will discuss more in the outcome part, because the teacher means something to be taught from outside, and Acharya means one who teaches by example. Next is Swalamban. The Gurukul culture encourages people to adopt a lifestyle of self-reliance. Right from morning till evening, all the activities like making bed, washing clothes, keeping surroundings clean, preparing food, etc. are to be done by the student himself or herself. Through this approach, life skills and survival skills are taught to the students. An interesting take on this approach was shared by an admiral in the SEAL Commandos of American Defense. He mentioned that while training, their officer asked them to make their own bed just after waking up. The rationale was that the person feels heads up after accomplishment of one task, and this provides him the motivation to the works following during the day. Following this disciplined routine is something very basic but plays a vital role in learning. This is very closely linked to the idea of Swavalamban. How this happens? Let's take a simple example. If a person gets up early, gets ready, does prayers and other rituals, has breakfast, goes to work, comes back, has dinner, and finally goes to bed, and all these activities are on time. So, all processes very systematically organized would help perfectly. The well-designed systematic approach allows the activities to become part of the subconscious mind and thus allowing the brain more space to learn.
I'm reminded of something interesting here. Most of us know that Mark Zuckerberg wears same colored t-shirt. When asked about it, he shared the same reason. Why should I waste time in choosing the dress every day?
Yes, that is really interesting and a wonderful example to put the point across. Moving further, finally, one of the most interesting ideas of Gurukul education, that is multi-channel learning. A shloka goes like, Acharyat Padam Adatte, Padam Shisham Swamedaya, Padam Sabrahmacharibhya, Padam Kalak Tramenacha. This shloka suggests that 1/4 of knowledge comes through each, Acharya, peers, through self-study and over the time, that is experiential knowledge. Now, we will discuss the most important aspect, that is the outcomes. First is, knowledge is within. The role of a teacher is to help child find it within him or her. The current model of teaching assumes that the student is blank and has some knowledge has to be delivered from outside. This was the idea that I was sharing, the concept of teacher, that a child is blank from inside and a teacher has to teach him something. While the Gurukul acknowledges the fact that every person has a knowledge and potential within, and the role of education and the teacher is to unearth the hidden knowledge within the student and enable him or her realize that.
That sounds incredible. However, I feel this would need a big paradigm shift in our education system.
Yes, Swami Vivekananda, while defining education, mentioned it is the manifestation of divinity already present within an individual. Yes, it is difficult but not impossible. And fortunately, the change has begun. You might be aware of the company called IDEO, the topmost design organization. They developed a concept of creative confidence, in which they state that everyone is creative, and as a guide or a mentor, the role is only to help the candidate realize his or her creative potential. And for management education, one of the latest skills required these days is design thinking. So, what's better than this to start with? They have also developed a design thinking toolkit for educators, and which is available for free, and anyone can download it and design the respective curriculum pedagogies to boost the creativity of students. Second is assurance of learning. The Gurukul system ensures that whatever the candidate learns, he or she becomes the master of that. The focus is not how much the candidate knows, rather how well the candidate knows whatever he or she knows. The education here is fully customized and as per the potential of an individual. Also, the promotion criteria is based on individual's growth with respect to self-improvement.
I agree on the need of customization, but in the current times, it seems difficult to achieve it. How should we begin?
Yes, there is a solution to it. We can begin with the idea of mass customization. This would mean that we maintain a certain level of standardization to meet the common needs and offer the customization to the extent possible. And for this, technology can really help. There are tools available to smoothen this process. So, moving further, the another dimension of outcomes is Savidya ya Vimukte. The education is one that liberates. Today, we see that education has become more of a transaction-oriented process and is mainly linked with employment. This approach towards education needs to be revisited. The idea of skills for employment is fine, but education serves a larger purpose. It is an overall man-making process. As we saw earlier also, that Swami Vivekananda rightly pointed out that education is the realization of divine potential already within the individual. So, we need to put the right focus of education again, which is not to just serve as a placement shop. Definitely, the skills are required and must be imparted, but the education should focus on holistic development of human qualities within the individual. With this aim, Professor Subhash Sharma coined an interesting phrase to replace human resource development with the word human quality development.
HQD, this sounds nice and very pertinent these days. And if I may add on, this could be one of the ways to achieve hope, which he defines
higher
as
order purpose of existence.
Yes, very well put. In fact, this links with the another outcome, that is on the character building. This outcome is the core focus of Gurukul system. These days, we see many companies and organizations clearly stating that they would prefer a person of high integrity even if the candidate is not highly skilled to a person who is excellent in skills but not so high on moral grounds. The Gurukul system always aims to produce individuals who are high on values. Here, the values are not taught, rather Acharya inculcates the values in the candidate through his or her own moral conduct. The word Acharya itself means one who teaches by example. This sums it all. We had a long discussion with various ideas and thoughts. Thus, to conclude, we can pose some questions for management teachers in form of opportunities to work towards the quality education. In terms of content, can we explore to design our courses in an integrated manner? The cases that we write are highly mundane in nature. Can we make them more interesting, just like stories from Puran, Ramayana, Mahabharata, Panchatantra, etc.? Can we design syllabus, theories to meet the diverse needs of candidates? Just like Upanishad, Ramayana, Puran, they carry the same knowledge of Ved, but in different forms like dialogues, analogies and metaphors. In terms of pedagogy, integrating life skills, survival skills into the curriculum, in the name of management education and professionalism, the core skills that are part of daily life should not be ignored. If the candidate performs his or her own daily course, one will understand the nuances of life of people coming from grassroots and different strata of the society. So, can we redesign the processes in our B schools to include some of these skills? Second, the concept of Acharya. Can we set example by walking the talk, whether it is marketing, finance, HR, ethos or sustainable development? In terms of outcomes, the application of design thinking into pedagogy for practical learning. This can help in assurance of learning, that is, whatever the candidate knows, he or she is master of that. Can we design our MBA program that is not just a placement program but a human quality development program?
Thanks for watching. We hope this could trigger many thoughts in your creative minds and thus will result in improving quality of management education.